Marco, and thank you for inviting me, and I'm very happy to be here. As I said, Marco, before we entered, I've been in IoT about 13 years ago, 14 years ago, so I'm very happy to come back. Obviously, new faces everywhere. So I'm going to speak with you today about the connectome in general, just to describe what is the connectome and what will be the role of neuroimaging in defining what the connectome is, in a way. And so we'll look at its structure, its function, and how it evolved, hopefully. So this is one of the most famous phrases in relation to brain connectivity, that of Marcel Mesrounam, that says that nothing defines better the function of the neurons than the connection it forms. And in a way, when we refer to the connections, we refer to the connectome. So the connectome is relatively new phrase in neuroscience that was introduced about 10 years ago, not from people in neuroimaging, not from people in transcriptography, but people who looked at sections of a single neuron and just computing the three-dimensional connections of a single neuron with all the different neurons that surround it, and then define the connectome on the microstructural level. So the connectome, on the most basic definition, is the mass array of all neural connections, not only neuronal, all neural connection, everything that you have in the brain, every cell that you have in the brain, all the connection that it forms, all the dense array of connections that you have in the brain. So the connectome is a map, is a graph that characterizes the connections that a region have, a neuron have, an assembly of neurons, a network of neurons. I don't want to make this confusing anymore. Spans across different scales. So you can look at the connectome of a single cell. You can look at the connectome at the columns and the column level. You can look at the connectome at the whole brain level. And so, one region when you start to explore it or to characterize it, you need to understand why it is important. And it's important because we think that the network is something that is meaningful to brain function, to brain cognition, and stuff like that. And to understand the network, we need to know the topology. Topology means which parts of the network connects to which other parts. And so these are basic things in neuroscience. So if you know the structure, if you know the topology, you might be able to say something about the function at the end, so this function-structure relations. And we do think, some people think that works on the connectome, that it affects our cognition and our behavior or some kind of correlation with those. And some people might go even further and say that as genes encode our body, the connectome encodes our mind. So you may agree or not agree with that, but these are the things that are in the behind the connectome research. So this is very, very basic. What are the structures of the connectome? All the cells that we have in the brain just form all the connections, not only neurons, but also glia. And this is quite significant because all the method that we have in cellular neurobiology goes to the neurons, were developed to look at the neurons. Only a few looks at the other cells, which are the majority, and actually they are the majority of the connectome. And maybe here, neuroimaging would have some kind of advantage. So the first way to look at the connectome was to go through electron microscopy. So in electron microscopy, you take the sample in the brain or whatever you look at, you cut it into tiny little pieces, and then you construct the different cell types and then form the connectome. So that was first done on this worm, on the C. elegans, and this is the electron microscopy of one section. When you zoom it up, you see all the different structure, and there are a lot of students very unhappy that goes and segment each part of the cells and then recreate the three dimension of that. But after doing that very tedious work, they were able to construct this connectome. So all the 302 neurons this C. elegans has were mapped. and all the connections between them. And then you have the connectomic data. And this is how it looks like. And no glia were mapped. This swarm has glial cells that supports the neurons. None of them were mapped in this connectome. Nobody knows anything about their connection. Obviously, they are more dense than the connection of the neurons. But even so, and that took quite a few years to construct. So just imagine that if you want to include also the glial cells, and this is clearly the neurons is nothing compared to a mammalian brain, just imagine the amount of work you need to put in just to construct that. So there are some movies which I don't want to go here in terms of time, just describing how the connectome is a series of electron micrograph, and then they reconstruct a network of cells and their connections, etc. So this is done on electron microscopy. And there's there is a debate about the connectome and the way it is studied. Is it worth it or not worth it, and what it can tell you about can tell us about brain function, etc. But eventually, people who are for it says that it gives you a full characterization of all neurons. Yeah, I'm sorry. Characterization of all the connections. It allows the investigation at a new level of details.
Let's call the guy the reconnect. The connectome guy.
The connectome of the connectome. The people who are against it says that there is an enormous amount of data and you don't know where to begin. For example, there is a guy in Germany that likes to do this electron microscope. Microscopy of the brain. He took a brain of a mouse and did the entire brain through the electron microscopy. The data is stored in one huge computer, and there is no even a software that can access the data because it's what they call it a big data analysis. This is a big issue now. Big data analysis. This is not big data. This is big data, and they don't know what to do with it. So nobody can even access the data. Only tiny little parts of it, and cannot extract nothing from it. So it's good that we have the methodology to look at it, but what are we going to do with this enormous amount of brain? Probably in the future, within, I don't know, 30, 40 years, there will be very huge computers that will be able to handle that, and maybe algorithms that will be, but at the moment, we don't know what to do with it. Then people said that when you do it with electron microscopy, that's done, the tissue is dead. You can't go back. You can't explore the dynamics of the connectome. And if we say that it is related to behavior and cognition, obviously, when it's alive, it's more important when the tissue is dead. So you can't do the structural function relations when the tissue is dead any longer. So if you can measure it only ex vivo, it's not worth it, and does not contain information about the cell. So there is a huge debate in that sense. Where the neuroimagers comes in. With a question to see or not to see, because when we are looking at neuroimaging, we always comes with images and say, here you can see that, and you can see that, and you can see that region, you can see that area, etc. But in relation to the connectome, the question is, do we really need to see every little tiny connection that we have in the brain, every little tiny connection of a neuron that there is, in order to know that it's there, in order to characterize it? So we don't need to see each synapse that we have in the brain. It's an overkill of amount of information that doesn't get us anywhere. We just need to know it's there and to characterize somewhat what's the connections that are there. And this is So just to look at this point further, so that there are two approaches to look, to see. Axons. One of them is the traditional, for example, to look at the electron microscopy, we just cut and see the axons. And another one of them is to use the non-traditional way, for example, Excalibur, which is a method that we developed a long time ago, which estimate the axon diameter distribution based on diffusion images and extract the axon. I don't see the axons. I don't see any of them. They are too small within the resolution of MRI, but I can sense them through diffusion imaging. So in terms of getting an analogy, it's like remote sensing. So in meteorology, you have this field of remote sensing where you from satellite remote the environment, and then you can say something about the weather, the atmosphere, etc. So this is the same way. We sense, we with diffusion imaging what's going on with the axons, and with nice algorithm you can extract something about their morphology. So I don't see the axons, but I sense them, and then I can get information. That's enough. Why do I need to sit and count every little tiny axon here on a very, very small area and to get and in a very tedious way when I can do a short experiment, get that kind of information, just characterize the same thing. So you don't need to see something to know it's there. And this is the basic concept. This is one of the ideas. So sensing axons, you can sense them. So that was done on the in vivo on the rat brain, something that could not have been done before. So you cannot measure the axon diameter in vivo, because all the methods that we have for measuring axons need to look at the axon. And if you need to look at them, you need to go to electron microscopy. But if you're using this method, you can sense them and get comparable information about their axon diameter. So with diffusion imaging on all its level, it's not, could be Excalibur, could be just regular diffusion tensor imaging with some fancy tractography algorithm. You can measure or sense different parts of the connector. And that was part of a project that was ended 2 years ago. It was an EU-based connector. There are many connect projects now. There is one of the NIH, the Connectom project, and there is the Human Brain project, which of the EU that is now part. A good part of it is measuring the connector through electron microscopy. But we did a few years ago at the Connect project, which was a joint adventure of a few groups, with the aim to develop technology that will not see every tiny little connection, but will sense them and will give us information about what is the connectivity behind it in a quantitative manner, so we can say something about it. And with the rationale that it is in vivo, and if it's in vivo, it can allow investigation of the dynamics of the connectome, and more importantly, it takes advantage of one of the disadvantages of MRI. So one of the disadvantages of MRI is not specific; you see everything. But this is a great advantage here because you want to see everything. I want to see all the connections. I don't care where they come from, if they are from glia or neurons or whatever. I just want to see them. So that was that. So we had 12 partners that worked together on that. Most of them are from the UK. So, all this stuff. So, looking at diffusion imaging, and I will go very briefly. This is basic diffusion imaging. I think that most of you have knowledge on diffusion imaging. So, just measuring the motion of water molecules. This is behind all the methodologies of diffusion imaging and extracting the microstructure, even if I don't see it. So I don't see every little cell, but each cell contribute to the signal based on its shape, based on its connection. So this is PTI, let's just go over that, the basic stuff. And with fiber tracking, eventually you can extract this connection, but on different scales and on different lengths, and then characterize the connectome in the form of either a quantitative parameter, like the most basic of them, mean diffusivity, is a quantitative marker of the connectome, because the denser the connections you will have, the lower the mean diffusivity will be. And that was shown by a few groups. It could be in relation to the FA. The higher the FA you have, the denser or more organized the connection is in the healthy brain, etc. So that can be done on different scales. For example, this is some of the connection that gets out of the occipital cortex, and then if you zoom in, you can extract even more of those and see different types of connection, and even zoom further, I think there's another movie coming here, zoom further and see different types of connection within the cortex if you measure it at very, very high resolution, this tiny little section. So you can do a lot of connectivity analysis with it at different scales. Depends what you look for. And depends. So this is tractography. You can do that tractography. So tractography, you know, you can extract it from DTI.
Yeah,
it's
kind of cool. Right, it's flickering.
Every now and then. Now it's stable.
Okay. Yeah. I'll leave it for now. Cause it takes 5 minutes to power it down and back up again. So if it's all right now.
If it's stable, then
okay. Thank you.
So you can do the tractography with the regular tensor. Those images were acquired with more advanced method, the charred method, or other method that allows you to characterize many, many fibers or many populations of connections within a voxel, and then you can get better quantitative measures out of it. And that's important not only in white matter. So when people think of tractography, eventually say, so this is for white matter mapping, only white matter, etc. But when you go to modern brain, and you do even regular DTI and the other sophisticated model, you can see that you can extract a lot of connections and a lot of information in the gray matter. For example, if you look on this area of the cortex, so behind that there is a dendrite. Immunohistochemistry for dendrites, so it shows you the orientation of the dendrites in green behind the green of the tensor. But the tensor information already shows you the orientation of the dendrites. So dendrites in the cortex contribute to the fractional anisotropy, for example, that you get there. And if you do more sophisticated method, you can even extract all the crossing fibers within the cortex. So there are some layers that have crossing fibers going that direction, and a few layers going the other direction. You can extract those, even if you don't see them. So you can have one voxel over the entire cortex and get all of that information. Yeah, so that was, most of that was the project of the Connect consortium, when we tried to map different types of connections throughout the brain with advanced method, not tensor-based cryptography, but other methods. Without going into it, so there were plenty of methods. Each group came with its own method, but we tried to do all of them and compare the different fibers. For example, to do connectivity based on axon diameter. So this is one of the challenges, which is still continuing. We didn't finish that, so we still continue to do it, which is quite challenging. You can imagine that someone may say that the axon diameter should be stable across the path. Some others say that, why should it? Because it is influenced by the myelin that you have, and the myelin is not stable because it is formed by the oligodendrocytes, and one oligodendrocyte one side of the path is not the same oligodendrocyte on the other side of the path, and those might cause different variation across the axon diameter. So you can think that this is something that is not trivial to map. But having this methodology alongside, we wanted just to get a feeling if this parameter is important to go even deeper into methodology, just to see if it's important to neuroscience. And one way to look at that is to see how dynamic the connectome is. If you measure quantitative measure of the connectome, you will see that in this project we use the most basic measure that any DTIs can give you, which is the mean diffusivity. And I will argue that this is a good characteristic of connectome, just to see how dynamic it is. So this is diffusion tensor imaging. We use the mean diffusivity here just because it is very robust. It's homogeneous across the brain. This is a lot of advantages when you do the image analysis, the registration and normalization, all the other stuff. If it's homogeneous, you get much less artifact when you do all these issues. The acquisition is fast, so if you have subject, you can finish the acquisition within a minute. That's not very stable information. Well defined in gray matter and in white matter, you don't have problems of a lot of noise. And the interpretation is simple. The denser the tissue is, the lower the mean diffusivity. And if you measure the same brain at two condition and something happened to the mean diffusivity, and you can tag this change to a specific task that is done, then you can know that the tissue became denser or less dense just because of that. So in this project, we gave our subject a Porsche and sent them to the streets of Monte Carlo to do a small track. And we scan them in the MRI before and after with the mean diffusivity. So we did also tractography and a lot of other stuff, but the mean diffusivity is a marker of the local connection, so the local density of the tissue. So this is a spatial navigation task. They don't know the track, so you can see the track here. They don't see it, they didn't see it. But they just drove the game again and again and again. Eventually the map was formed. So basic spatial navigation tasks. They were scanned in the MRI before that. Then they played 16 times divided into 4 sessions, and then they were put in the MRI again. The interval was 90 minutes, not more than that. Here you can see after each round, we asked them to draw the track. So they didn't see the track at all. And this is already, so the black, the dashed line is the track. The black is one subject, how we drew it after 4 rounds, 8 rounds, 12 rounds, 16. And you can see that after the 16th round, he didn't see the track, but he was able to draw it, which means that he has the map in his brain. So this is purely spatial navigation. And the latency, the amount of time it took to complete the track, reduced significantly. What we found is that the mean diffusivity after 90 minutes of training, the mean diffusivity in specific regions in the brain, not surprising, it's the hippocampus, well, it's spatial navigation, short-term memory, it's the hippocampus must be involved, but the method was sensitive. The mean diffusivity as a marker of tissue density of I thought I wanted to believe a connection density, and I had to prove it, and we'll see in a minute how. So the density or the mean diffusivity here reduced significantly in the group that learned. There were a few control groups without going into that. We had to control for other parts of the task. So there is a motor sequence learning, there are some other kinds of memory involving. So we had to control for that, we had to control for the stability of the scanner, etc. So in these regions, only the one that had spatial navigation learning had reduction. So this is involved the hippocampus, the power hippocampus, which was also in correlation to the behavior or the improvement rate in the task of the subjects. And there were some also other effect, the gender effect, which is never nice. Go into that at the moment, and other regions were the insular cortex. So in a sense, this is a very nice method where you can measure human subjects which you can't do electron microscopy on or any other type of neurobiological manipulation, just to measure it before and after some kind of task and see what happened in the brain in terms of their connection. And in a sense, it's can be related to fMRI, but with fMRI, when you do that, you are looking at the current activity in the brain. You don't see the traces of it. You don't see what is more. So when you do a car racing game, I can believe that most of your brain lights up because you're doing a lot. Multiple domains are involved in that, but only few of them are related specific to the task, to the spatial learning. Some of them are related to attention or to the visual information that comes in. Or whatever. And with that method, you clear them up because you just look at the changes that are involved in the task and not in the. So that was that game. But since then, we have done it on other domains. So one of them was the language domain, which here, over here, she did this experiment. So that was taking subject and then them to learn new words or flowers, which they didn't know. So they knew, maybe they knew the flowers, they didn't know their names. Their names quite tricky. So they had to learn them and to assign them to the specific flower, and eventually we did find structural changes in the relevant areas, the inferior frontal gyrus, etc. And there was also a task of motor sequence learning where the subject had to play the first 15 notes of release, we'll come to that, which affected the motor network. But the question is that always arises is, what is the relation between the, well, I say connectome changes, that's fine, but people in neurobiology, at least in my department, look at it and said, what is the connectome? Show me the synapse, I want to see the synapse. This is, neurobiology is all about synapses, just only what happened in the synapse. This is what we know from textbooks about neuroplasticity, LTP, synaptogenesis, maybe some other genesis in the brain. They wanted to see how things that comes from the MRI, this yellow blobs, relates to that. And there are many evidences in the literature about structural plasticity. The famous Jaglik paper, things related to music learning, our paper, the taxi drivers, from a grad group, not far from here. And the question, how are those related? Yeah. So what we did, lucky for us, we had also an preclinical experimental MRI scanner, and we tried to replicate that study on rodents. And here we use the Morris water maze. So the Morris water maze is a spatial navigation task, we know everything about it. We know where it is located in the brain. We know all different variations you have on it. So we know where to look for it. So the most widely used paradigm in behavioral psychology, for those of you who don't know, there's a pool of water, you take a rat, there is a heat, there is a platform, but it's hidden, it's lowered, so we don't see it. You put it in the pool, you show her where, you put it on the platform so it knows where it is, it looks around, and the next time you put it, it tries to look for it based on spatial cues. So there are pictures around, and when you put the rat, you just try to find it and get to the pool. And from time to time, it finds it faster and faster just because it remembers where it is. And as in the humans, you do MRI, so the conventional water maze is a 5-day task. Each day they swim 4 times, and from day to day they remember where the platform is. So this is for one specific rat. You see the path that he did in the first day, second day, third day, fourth day, and fifth day. So you can see that it remembers where the platform is located, and at the end it just swims there. Now you can see it in a movie. So this is one of the rats of the first day. Doesn't know what to do, just swim around, but a bit stressed, but eventually it will find the platform. The same rat after a day 5 knows exactly what to do. There it is. And you can see that it's very interesting to look at, because when you put them at the pool at the fifth day, they don't swim, they don't stress, they are not stressed anymore by the water. They just stand, they look to the left, to the right, try to see the different cues, and then swim directly to where the platform is. So the time to find the platform reduces, and also with the mean diffusivity, we found a reduction in the mean diffusivity in the areas that were accessed. So nothing new in terms of brain localization. We knew that the hippocampus, that the dendrogyrus is affected in this work. We knew that the sensory cortex, that the amygdala, and other areas of the brain are affected. And we could, there was also control groups, but maybe it was the details, but we could characterize it. Very similar to the human studies. What we could do in rodents, couldn't do in humans, is to take the brain out and try to see what happened. And we tried everything, literally every marker that is known in neurobiology, to look at the morphology of the neurons, of the synapses. We tried nothing. Nothing. There is more expression of proteins in the synapses. There is no increase in the amount of them, not only 5 days. It takes more for that to have an increase in the amount of synapses. That takes time to build up. And nothing in the shape of the dendrites, nothing in the number of the neurons. Neurogenesis is a process that takes more time to evolve, takes weeks for the neurons to survive more in the region that is plastic, etc. And the student that did this work said, I have a few other markers for glial cells, and I will try those as well. I said, go ahead, I don't care. We already have the markers, we already paid for them, so just use them. And what you're going to see in the next movie are 2 sections of the hippocampus taken from a confocal microscope. A state for neurons, those are in red, and for astrocytes in green. And the marker for astrocytes is called GFAP. It's a marker that when the astrocytes are become active, we know that from stroke and trauma studies, when the brain is injured, then the astrocytes become active, and then it is a common way to do it. So this is how it looks in the naive brain. So you can see the neurons, and you can see the astrocytes, star-shaped. So you can see it there, we can move it again. The same amount of reagent GFAP, the same area in the brain, but for a red, the middle water maze. Just look what happened to the astrocytes. They have more connections. It's the same amount of protein. The astrocytes became active, and when astrocytes became more active, they produce more connections. This is what astrocytes do. They create more connections with neurons. This is connected.
Sorry, you mean more myelinations of already existing axons?
No, this is astrocyte, not only with astrocytes. So this is astrocyte, nothing related to myelin.
So these are not new axons, region?
No, it's for the neurons in the dendrogyrus. No axons, no white matter, no nothing. Just the astrocytes that accompanies the synapses of the neurons. So each synapse needs an astrocyte to be there just to take away the glutamate. So it's there. And if for some reason the synapses, so this is something basic that, you know, on Nuremberg they said, yes, I didn't know, but they said yes, of course. Every synapse that needs to work needs an astral site nearby just to take the glutamate. The astral site cannot control all the synapses that the neuron has, so it controls it when they need it. And when they need it, they just reshape themselves. So, not unlike the neurons that it takes days to weeks to reshape their structure if they need to, astral site do it in seconds. Because this is what they, and if, even if you look at cell culture with astral site under the microscope, you see that the probe is moving and trying to get to reach places. The neurons just stand there, don't do anything, and the astral sites are trying to reach places. So this is a very, very dynamic cell that forms a lot of connections with everything that it needs. Most of them are synapses and blood vessels, on the other hand, because it controls the hemodynamic response, controls the blood flow to the brain, as we know from the fMRI. But not only that, it controls the glutamate uptake at the synapse. So, and it creates, it changes its morphology within a second, changes its connectome. The connectome of the astral site changes. It can't reach all synapses at once, but when it needs, it just reshapes itself to the synapse to take the glutamate. So that, yes? Glutamate spectroscopy. Well, at the time of the function, for sure, because you release more glutamate. When it becomes to rest, maybe if it reached LTP, it doesn't have to, but maybe if the neuron reached LTP, there is some excess of glutamate just going around there that you might get, but all the images were done at rest, so maybe you don't see increasing the amount of glutamate. But I don't know. Something we need to check. But once we have the method, and the method is very simple, taking just the mean diffusivity, looking before and after, and we have some sort of biological mechanism that put to rest the neurobiologist, at least my department, and say, okay, so this is solid, this is okay. Obviously, you're looking at something that is nice. Then you can use it in order to see how the connectome evolves and how it's dynamic and what happens over time with it. So in one of the studies, which I started to show you, we used Forelis. Forelis, for those of you who don't know, it should have played it, but I will sing it. So just to learn the first 50 notes of Forelis. And so it's a motor sequence learning. You just need to hit the keyboard at the right time. We did baseline MRI, then they had to first, the learning and accuracy, learn the first 50 notes. So as you can see, so they learned, so you can see, at each time they had to learn 3 notes, and then we added another 3 notes, and then another 3 notes, eventually until we reached 50 notes. So you can see how most of them reached the level that they remembered all the 50 notes. Then we did the MRI just to see what happened with that. We tried to see how dynamic this changes, how dynamic, how these new connections that are formed in the astral site. And we try to shift their attention into a different domain. So if the first is a motor sequence learning, the second will be to use the timing. So when you already know the notes, now play them in the right timing, so the melody will be as it was supposed to be. you hear it as it was supposed to be. And after you do it, so this is a shift in the attention domain. So you can see there is also learning in the timing, so the timing becomes better. None of them was a professionalist piano player, so all of them was the first time they had to play this. And then we did the MRI again. And what we found here, so in the first part of the task, which is the accuracy, we found changes in several brain regions that you can imagine that would be involved, the premotor area. All of them are heavily corrected for any kind of multiple comparison that you can maybe think that you have in the brain, so you see tiny little areas. But if you won't do them as severely corrected, you can see a huge bulb around the premotor area. Temporal gyrus, several parts of it, and the cerebellum, the other side, were affected, which is nice. But just changing the attention of the subject to a different domain, not accuracy, but timing, reduced the effect in this area. This is how dynamic this changes, how reduced the effect. You can no longer, they didn't pass the statistical threshold afterward, but you find changes in other areas, prefrontal gyrus, the lingual cortex, etc., that were affected by the timing. So you can see the shift in this area, how dynamic these changes are, and if they are related to astrocyte, and astrocyte can change in the second, so they can form a structure and they can retract back if they don't need to. So that was about the dynamics and the relations to function of the connectome. And the last thing that I want to show you is something that we work is how the connectome has evolved. And I was fortunate enough to work with a zoologist, which is a good colleague of mine, that works on bats, on echolocation of bats. And for some reason, he wanted to do fMRI on bats, just because bats can hibernate in the scanner, so you don't need to anesthetize them. So you can do very nice fMRI on them, which didn't succeed eventually, just because I think they were just too stressed in the magnet, and the noises of the magnet and what he tried to do with the echolocation just mixed up and they didn't know what happened. And some of them ran away from me. Without going into details, you can imagine how it looked like. The one interesting thing that when he put, so I didn't know anything about bats. Just all of them are flying around Tel Aviv and you know, taking the fruits of the trees and throwing them on the walls of the buildings. It looks like. I didn't know anything about the bats. But so the fruit bat, the common fruit bat, has a very unique structures in the brain. He has a lot of white matter, much more than you can expect. So I thought it's like a rat with wings, but it's really not. They have bigger brains, a bit convoluted already. And it's interesting that the first thing that he told me, that bats, you know how long bats live? Any idea? So a rat lives about 2 years. A common fruit bat lives 40 years. And this is amazing. So if he lives 40 years, it needs to have a brain that can store all the information that he gets there. A lot of connection, a lot of the cortex already, a bit convoluted, a lot of interesting things. And every week, he bought a different kind of bat, just because he had so many of those, every different kind of bat, and which I started to compare the brains of different bats. And then he said, why to stop at bats? Let's have all kinds of mammals. And then it became a bit bizarre, because we started to look for dead animal brains in many places. So we went to the zoo, the Tel Aviv Zoo, and some other places where you have animals. And those occasionally die, not intentionally for this project, but they die for some reason. For example, in the Tel Aviv Zoo, they thought it would be nice to put a small little antelope in the cage in the area of the giraffe. But when a giraffe walks, it doesn't look down what's going on. And eventually one of the antelope, which were quite rare, was killed. So we had the opportunity to look at the brain. And so this is how we collected the different species in the project. So none of them were intentionally killed for this project, I can assure you. But we were fortunate to get the samples. So already 4 years we are collecting this database. We call it the MAMI database, which is the mammalian MRI database. It consists, it's written here 62, but already we have 87 different species and counting. Every week something else comes up. Already the veterinary service in Israel, which get all the dead animals around the country just to say to look for different pathogens. And they already know that they should keep the brain for me. And every week there is a taxi driver that goes bring the brains to Tel Aviv University. We scan them and then we bring them. So we already scanned 87 different species. For most of the species, we already have replicas. So it's about 140 different samples. Just covering most of the organs, not all of them, most of the organs. We don't have few organs that do not exist in the zoos in Israel. Most of them are from Australia. But we have most of the organs, and for each order, a few families that we could compare. the analysis pipeline just to do a comparative diffusion imaging protocol. And that was quite challenging because these brands are at very huge different scale of sizes. So we had to fix the amount of information. So the idea is to fix the amount of information you acquire so it will be comparable. So the information, as it is, just information, what you acquire, should be comparable across the different species, and then to do analysis. So once the information is comparable, just keeping the comparable resolution and signal to noise similar across the different species. You compute fiber tracks, which your favorite, which any favorite method that you can think of, whatever. From that, we did some graph theory analysis, extracting the connectivity matrix, doing network analysis, and then extracting three basic parameters of the graph theory. The most basic of them was the mean throughput path. So if that's our one of the... So this is for human, how it looks like. This is how would be the connectivity matrix. And here we didn't segment to region. That's because we can do region analysis for human brain because we know where the different areas are. We can't do it for all the different species because we don't know. So we just had to go from each voxel to all the other voxels. So this is a huge matrix. Again, an issue of big data analysis that we have to deal with. From there, we do small network analysis to see what is the efficiency of the connectivity. And so there are some issues in graph theory which I don't even know about, but from that we can extract all different parameters, like the MSP, the mean short path, which is very basic. So this is just an example for, so this is the example for the human brain. If you think that the professor of neurobiology in Tel Aviv can represent humankind. We had a few monkeys in the database. This is a hyena, a fruit bat, a red kangaroo, a rabbit, a white bat. So you can do a comparison of how different the amount of information in all those scans were exactly similar. But look how different the connectivities are, the connections. And just to compare, so this is the smallest animals that we had. This is the trident bat. The trident bat as a whole animal weighs 6 grams. So you can think how tiny and little the tiny, tiny, tiny little brain. But again, you can extract a lot of fibers. You can see here the fornix and what sort of corpus callosum that he has, etc. So you can extract it. It took about 4 or 5 days to acquire the data on that tiny little animal. And this is the striped dolphin brain that we were fortunate to have. So the dolphin weighs 150 kilos. The brain is something like that. I just showed Marco the images before that, so something like that, which was scanned not on the 7 Tesla, but on the 3 Tesla, just because it's big. And so the information is comparative between them. And from that, we can compute several things. So if you go into comparative anatomy of the brain, the most important issue that these people work on is the relation between gray matter, white matter, volumes, and brain size, and stuff like that. And there is a fixed relation in literature that as the brain is bigger, it has more white matter. This is a fixed relation, and there is a rule that it should be at least to the power of 1.2 in relation. So the larger the brain is, to the power of 1.2, your white matter will be bigger than that. And we were able to replicate this relation on our database. So you can see different animals, the gray matter, white matter volume, gray matter volume, and you can see the relation. So this is okay, which means that the MRI can replicate what is known from comparative anatomy studies, which is nice. What we could do is to extract then for each animal the mean short path and see what is the relation between the mean short path as you extract it from tractography and brain volume. And there is none. There is no relation. So the efficiency of connections that you have in the tiny, tiny little trident bat and the efficiency of connection in the huge human or dolphin brain are the same, which is striking in my view. The tiny little brain of the trident bat that does a lot of things and just connects as efficient as the human brain. It doesn't mean that it is the same cognitive system. Obviously, his brain has evolved to do different things that we do, but for the different things, the efficiency of connectivity is comparable. So this is not a significant line, it's like a threshold, it's not significant. From there we try to explore what would be the sources of that. What we were able to show, so we just started to explore the data in many ways just to see where we can find the hint of what's going on with the connectivity. And the one thing that we found out that there is a huge variability in the amount of commissural volume. For example, there are some animals that has a huge commissural fibers just connecting the two hemispheres, huge commissural, like the wolves, the deer, some of the triangulates. They have a lot of commissural fiber. And some animals that don't. The mouse, for example, only 30%. The dolphin, I don't think it's in the graph, but there's about 10% of only commissural fibers. Not much information passing through the hemisphere there. So there is a huge variability in the commissural fiber. And if, so the commissural fibers are one of the most important features of connectivity in the brain, because it just we have two bulbs, the hemisphere, and this is the only path that brings information between. So it shortens the path from one side to the other side, and increases the efficiency of the network. So the basic thing in graph theory. But what happens, so if a mouse brain is as efficient as the wolf brain, but it has much less commissural fibers, it should be more efficient elsewhere. It should have better connections elsewhere. So we try to see if there is a relation between this variability and things that happens within the hemisphere. And what we found that there is striking linear relation. So inner hemispheric mean short path versus brain mean, the total brain mean short path compared with the commissural ratio. So the lower the commissural ratio is, the better the efficiency within the hemisphere. The efficiency of transfer of information means that you have better association connection in the hemisphere if you have less commissural fiber. As a representative of the humankind, I didn't do so well, I'm here. Maybe we should scan others just to see if they are more efficient.
It was incredible that the domestic pig
has got the best ratio. But for human, it's like one of the dogs.
Yeah.
So we've done that. And from that, you can recreate an evolution tree, but evolution that is not based on the phylogenetic information, not on vegetal genetic, but based on connectivity. So that would be a connectome or a connectivity evolution, which is quite different, because something stands out from this connectivity, looking just the evolution tree of the mean short path. In the brain, or the commissural variability connectivity. You can make evolution tree for each one of these fibers. You can see that some of the species start to, for example, the most variable order is the one of the bats. Because the bats are quite, so the bats, for example, were first characterized as a primate. In the very, very early evolution studies, just because they have active sensing as we do with the eyes, they have with their ears. So they thought they are primates. Then they thought that they are more related to rodents in a way. Then they put them in a sample over there. But if you look at the, at, for example, so the bats are here. But if you look, if you create an evolution tree based on commissural fibers, you can see that some of the bats, the ones that are more cognitively evolved will be here along the primates, and some of them will be with the carnivores, the vampire bats. Bat, the vampire bat looks like a cat in a way. So there's a lot of information hidden in the connectome that you can eventually extract and learn more about how our brain function evolved in this. To summarize everything, the main thing that I wanted to pass is that you don't need to see, and this is very difficult for people in neuroimaging, because what we do is we see, we look at images, this is what we do. But to look at the connectome, you don't need to see it in in order to know it's there and to characterize it. So within a voxel, there is a lot of information that you can extract the sub-voxel patterns, connections, whatever there, without seeing any of those. You just need to believe it. It does not believe it. You need to believe it's there. And the diffusion, MRI in general, and diffusion in particular, is a very, very powerful tool to investigate this connectome at different scale. And we were able to show that the connectome is dynamic, probably related to the connectome of the glial cells, not of the neuron, but it's very dynamic. It can change in minutes. And we can study the role of the connectome now with this method in behavior and cognition. The brain has a small world. Small world means that it's efficient with small activity, light ability, to connect within itself. And this characteristic is well preserved in evolution. And if you look at bioinformatics, when you find a gene that is preserved in evolution, it means that this gene is very critical, it's very important. And if this property of the brain, unlike the convolutions of the brain, unlike many other things that you look at the brain, this is very preserved, means that this is very, should be very important to behavior. And this is just the beginning. So there's a lot of things to do with this connectome. Luckily for us, we have now a very good method to look at and very nice data to explore. And I want to thank my colleagues, especially Yossi Ovel, with whom I did the evolution study, and the others, and the wonderful students that works are doing at the University. Thank you very much.